Hey, Tanchikia. Hello, everybody. How are you? I spoke in Machif language. Hello, how are you, folks? I'm Derek Weisskey at Cloud. Welcome to CFRO 101.5 FM, this Métis Matters Radio, and here at beautiful downtown Vancouver, Co-op Radio. And today it's going to be a wonderful week. Has been a wonderful week for all of us, I'm sure. So many things have actually happened in the community, and it's been busy for me because last weekend I actually was at a powwow. We did some really cool things. We did the veterans powwow and honored the veterans, and not just last week before that. And so I've been like so busy. I've just been absolutely freaking crazy. It's like it's been good. It's been good. This coming week, everyone's been involved a lot with the veterans, Métis veterans, First Nations veterans, Indigenous veterans, all over. Last week I did my program where I was honoring them as well. This week we are, I guess to say, honoring another type of veteran, and that's a man who actually fought for this country, and or I guess it was called the lower part of Canada at the time when it became a dominion at the time before it became Canada itself, because we had Upper Canada and Lower Canada, and so we would be talking about Louis Riel and also how he became a Métis icon, and also we're going to talk about the exoneration. Should he be exonerated? Should Louis Riel be exonerated because of his, defending the people, the Métis in the community? And we'll be getting your feedback as well. And I also want to welcome everybody in the Facebook chat room that we are live. And hello, everyone. And today I'm going to actually have a good friend of mine who actually I've known for many, many years. I worked with him in the Métis community. He's also the curator of the Machif Historical and Cultural Preservation Society, which people call the Métis Museum. And he's located up in Clearwater here in British Columbia. And he's been busy with the museum up in that area. It's been a busy summer, I'm sure. And I asked Dale to come on back. His name is Dale Haggerty. Dale, are you there, my friend?
Hey, how are you guys?
I am doing well.
Good. First of all, Derek, I'd like to wish all our listeners and all our Métis people across Canada from sea to sea happy Louis Riel Day coming up Friday. And we'll have more discussions on that, but I just want to wish everybody have a good day on that day and honoring our leader.
Well, the Métis community throughout British Columbia is thirsting for Métis culture and education about our history. And the question remains now, where do we go? And is it clear to the, say, for example, for the BC Métis Federation that Louis Riel needs to be exonerated and by the government of Canada without delay? Louis Riel is a Métis, our Métis hero, and it is our duty and obligation to readdress this historic injustice and carry forward with Métis pride. Do you think that you yourself believe that should Louis Riel be exonerated? And before we say that, let's talk about his history and why he became, and because he was considered as a defender of the people in Batoche and as well as other locations. Should he have been exonerated, or should he have been considered as a traitor of Canada?
If you're looking, and this is just my opinion, I don't take this the wrong way from people. I have a voice. First of all, when you say exonerated, there's a word that means that he has been proven not guilty. Well, first of all, he wasn't guilty. He didn't commit a crime. He was charged on a British law. So as far as I'm concerned, there is no exoneration. He shouldn't have never, ever been brought to court on that kind of a charge. This is John A. Macdonald's stupidity of not thinking that he brought this charge and it was a British law. And we weren't British. We were Canadian by this time. 1867, Canada became its own country. We had our own constitution. Well, I think we had a constitution, or at least the start of it. And we were having our own laws. And, they say he took arms against Canada. Well, he didn't. He had a gun, but he didn't shoot anybody.
No, he didn't.
And no, he was just a leader.
Yeah, he was a leader. I don't, as far as we know, no, but he didn't take up a firearm. In fact, in the very end, he took the flag of truce. Like he did not want anyone to die.
That's right. He gave himself up.
Mm-hmm. That doesn't mean he was overwhelmed. He did not want to see any more people die. I mean, any more Métis die, because exactly. how many soldiers came down and were shooting everybody?
Yeah.
Compared to we just had well over 100 people. These are just civilians, regular people, who were just hunters, trappers, fishermen.
Yeah.
And if I remember correctly, they had maybe about 10 or 12 sharpshooters who are expert hunters, but they're just hunters. These are black powder rifles. These aren't common Winchester type rifles. You're not John Wayne movie.
That's right. Exactly. So, you know, we have to look at that word exonerate. I mean, he was not guilty in the beginning, but if we say that he's exonerated, then he's guilty.
Mm-hmm.
You see, so I think, and this is just my opinion, the word exonerated is the wrong word we needed. He should be excused. He should have been excused from even being charged. That's more like it. But what can we do about it now? He's hung. They hung him.
Yeah.
You know, what can we do to bring him back? Or, you know, what, pay us off with little bits of money and say, we're sorry? You know?
Well, you know, you look at it, Dale, there are so many Métis groups we have that split over proposals to the exoneration of Louis Riel. And history has been rewritten, and much of the public's opinion has long since changed. And Riel, who we would call our Métis leader, like most people don't know, was executed as a traitor of Canada in 1885. But here's the crazy part, you know, we're still talking about him.
I know.
You know, 1885, we're still talking about him. You know, we're still provoking a fight. You know, to get this done. I mean, that's over 130 years.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, like he was executed over 130 years. He was tried and hanged for treason. And the people they fought and died, I mean, basically was for the freedom. I mean, that's what most people call it, Optimum Misiwak.
Yeah.
You know, free people.
That's right.
And yet, our next step now is to take what you call political rehabilitation. You know, like we need to really, if you remember correctly, Dale, Tourism Canada, as not just Tourism Canada, but also anybody who is actually wants to be a citizen of Canada, they have to, if you look into their immigration papers, their documents, in there it says, one of the documentations states that they have to study that word and believe that Louis Riel was a traitor of Canada. It's actually one of the historical written words that the public themselves that moved to this country from another country has to write down true, that he was actually a traitor of Canada. And does this man deserve to have that written for the public, the new citizens of Canada, to read this and to accept this, or should that be removed?
Oh no, that's definitely removed. But that's a government thing that they want to do to see if we can stir the pot up.
Yeah.
You see, the problem with us Métis people, we all have an individual mind, so we all don't think alike, but we all think in the same lines to a certain point, and then we all fight amongst each other. Well, they love it. Hey, let's throw another log in the fire. Let's see if we can get the Métis stirred up again.
Mm-hmm.
Let's start. Okay, Manitoba, okay, we're going to give you $20 billion and screw the rest of the country. Excuse me if I can say that. Let them fight over it. Hey,
Mark said it was okay to say.
Here's $5 million, and Let's see if we can get them squirming. You know what I'm saying? And they love it. They just love it. They're going, oh, we're going to throw another log in the fire and get these guys going and fight amongst each other. You know, if we had any god darn balls,
doggone
we
it.
Would find
doggone
a leader it. That would lead us into the 20th century and take us out of this goddamn thing. We have words out there, you know? I don't know what's wrong.
How Catholic of you.
Everybody wants to be the chief in council, and nobody wants to do the work. Why don't we just find a leader to take us to the next level?
Yes.
You know, everybody, you know, British Columbia's apparently, well, I haven't seen that many, but 60,000 Métis in British Columbia. There's got to be at least a 500,000 in Manitoba and Saskatchewan. Come on, we've got a voice. We can elect leaders into the parliament and change things. What's wrong with us? What's wrong with this picture, you
well,
know?
What they're, I mean, if you look, think about it, Dale, I mean, the Métis in Montreal knew that Riel was innocent.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Because that's where Riel's family was from, originally up in that area. It was the Montreal region. And, like, we talk about Red River. You know, like, here's what the Métis kept talking about, saying, well, Louis Riel was Red River. Yes, when he migrated there, yes, he was Red River. But he was not Red River before.
Yeah, well, hey, listen, Derek, my great-grandparents, which is Isidore Villeneuve, yeah, or Isidore Villeneuve, they were from Fort Edmonton, for goodness sakes, in the 1700s.
Yeah.
Eventually, they ended up in the Red River and got and part and found part of being there. My great-grandmother, Matilda Henry, she was from the Henry line, mm-hmm, and she was an American. I mean, their ancestors were all from New Jersey. And come on, let's get real.
Yeah.
But you know, again, what I'm trying to say to you guys, and I apologize if I get so excited, but we need a leader to take us to the next level, and let's stop fighting amongst each other. You know, we could be so powerful with our voice.
There is a heritage minister, her name is Melanie Jolies, and the office, you should acknowledge it, is actually trying to determine how to best to honor Riel. So the ideals that Louis Riel fought for, ideals of inclusiveness and equality, are the very same values in which we base our country's identity. Now, which is Pierre-Olivier Hébert, he spoke. And then the campaign to exonerate Riel is being led by a Francophone Métis group, in Manitoba, who want to see Canada use its 150-plus anniversary celebration to right a historic wrong. And Riel should receive a complete exoneration without any conditions. And the group, L'Union Nationale Métis Saint-Belge-Joseph, which dates to 1887, writes in a 70-page dossier that was submitted to the federal government last couple years ago, which was provided to the Star. Now, the group cites legal irregularities that would be grounds for modern-day mistrial, as well as Riel's legislative cultural contributions to Canada, such as Aboriginal land rights, minority land rights, the founding of the province of Manitoba, and the legitimization of a distinct founding people of mixed European and indigenous ancestry, the Métis, agents of change and conduits between cultures who embody Canadian values even before Canada formally existed, must receive justice and honor for Louis Riel, their leader, the group argues in the document. And our Métis groups are promising trouble if Ottawa dares to make such a move without their consent. Now, it would be very wise, unwise of them, warned David Chartrand, president of the Manitoba Métis Federation. This would probably alleviate Canada's stress and pressure and guilt that they have maintained when the facts are very clear that they murdered this great leader. Exoneration is not about Riel. Exoneration is about Canada. Now, Riel's critics are also warning that Ottawa risks an implicit endorsement of armed rebellion against the forces of law and order by clearing Rial's conviction. The relatively low-profile exoneration campaign was ushered into the spotlight this week when it got the backing of the Montreal City Council. The Quebecois have always had a soft spot for the Francophone firebrand, who was educated and later hospitalized in the province after being diagnosed by psychiatrists as suffering from megalomania, a disease described as at his treason trial as an insane and extraordinary love of power. But this movement was really been building since former Prime Minister Joe Clark passed a motion in the House of Commons recognizing Rial's major contribution to the development of Canada as we know it. Now, that was in 1992 when Ottawa was trying to round up support for constitutional amendments in the Charlottetown Accord, which was ultimately defeated. Now, since then, there have been more than a dozen bills tabled in the House of Commons where Rial was elected three times as MP and for Provence, but never permitted to take his seat. Each sought the posthumous cancellation of the guilty verdict in his treason trial. And each was shuffled away and ignored by successful governments, never coming close to a vote. Now, we never give up, absolutely not. Our position has always been that unless Rial is exonerated, reconciliation doesn't really occur, said our writer, David Doyle, a Rial activist and author. And it would be similar to South Africa. If they hadn't exonerated Nelson Mandela, reconciliation would not have occurred, and we feel the same way about Rial. The Métis National Council, which has represented Métis organizations in Ontario, Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and British Columbia since 1983, a little excitement about that one, fears an exoneration would only be used to shift attention away from more concrete and pressing demands of its people. We have nothing against honoring Louis Rial, said Clément Charchet, the council president. What we're opposed to is whitewashing history to try to mask the grave injustice that was done not only to the Métis Nation, but to Louis Rial. He would rather see the favorable shift in public opinion toward the Métis leader harnessed to address current issues. And even if they do these other things, we still may not be favorable to an exoneration by whatever terms they want to use, Charchet said. We're not saying it's a quid pro quo. We're just saying that let's rectify the wrongs. Let's not dwell on symbolism, because symbolism is not going to feed our people or our house or our family or employ our people. Jacqueline Blay, president of the CESET, Francophone Manitoban, which is also pushing for Rial's exoneration, acknowledged the split among Métis organizations, but she argued that the 150th plus anniversary of Canada's founding is the time to correct a historical injustice, not to carry on the maneuvering and partisanship that doomed previous efforts to rehabilitate Rial. Mm-hmm. Now, Blay, a historian, was actually the author of the dossier submitted to the Federal Heritage Minister and noted that it was based as much as possible in incontrovertible facts in order to remove any element of political whimsy from Ottawa's eventual decision. Now, Rial should be exonerated because it's been too long that he has been vilified, scorned, and ignored, and unjustly accused of treason. In fact, his trial should never have been held, she said. That's always the opinion by also our good writer and friend, George Goulet. He was a lawyer, and he is a Métis scholar who also, along with his wife Terry, wrote the 1999 book, The Trial of Louis Rial. And I read that book, and so did Dale. And I mean, it gets your attention, folks. I mean, it really does. Goulet's main argument is that Rial was improperly tried and convicted under an English statute of treason that dated in 1351. And he said that the charge was made under that law for the sole reason that it carried a penalty of death. In fact, he said that the law was not even applicable in Canada, which adopted its own treason law in 1868. So they took that from 1351 and made it a law in 1868. In addition to that, Riel's appointed defense lawyers argued against his wishes and that the Métis leader was not guilty because he was insane, an argument rejected by the jury. Charles Fitzpatrick, the Quebec city lawyer who led Riel's defense, was also related by marriage to Adolphe Philippe Caron, the minister of militia and defense, when Riel clashed with the Canadian forces. Fitzpatrick should never have taken the case when he had those conflicts, George Goulet said.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, this is the thing. Here we have the truth. This is the facts, folks. We have the truth that's showing that this is what they used. They labeled Riel an insane man in 1351. They took an old British law.
Yeah.
And they passed it in, and they made it a new law, basically recreated it back in 1868, and they're saying it's treason.
Yeah.
Because you objected against the government. That's very wrong.
That's right. And especially when all this stuff was happening, Saskatchewan wasn't even a province.
No, it wasn't, not even yet.
No, they haven't even, a matter of fact, the government of Saskatchewan of the day was the provisional government of the Métis.
Okay.
Yeah, and so how should the soldiers have even entered Saskatchewan? They illegally and you know, that's just like invasion. You know what I'm saying?
Uh-huh.
You know, they were just. It was all about the railway. It was all about the money. It was Louis Riel was a thorn. And John A. McDonald's, excuse me, behind.
Yeah.
That's what it was all about. And
that's
he knew if the educated Louis Riel got back into Parliament, the Conservative government would have lost control and they would have never been elected back into the government because the truth would have came out.
And that's the thing. That's one thing that McDonald was afraid that Riel was too strong, and he wanted him eliminated. He wanted him out of the way. And besides that, and it also includes the Pacific Railway, folks. So there's so much to the story.
Oh yeah.
You know, it also became a religious issue. So you know, you've got. You know, we'll go more into that, but we're going to do, Dale. We're going to go and take and play a song here.
Yeah.
And this song actually is called The Quebec Reel. It's J.J. Lavallee's work. And CFRO 100.5 FM. Join me, Derek Watsky Cloud. I am your host every Wednesday night from 5 to 6 p.m. for Métis Matters Radio, where we discuss why Métis matters and the worldwide matters of Métis people. From the past to the present, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. on Vancouver's Co-op Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM.
Who owns your radio?
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 You do!
Vancouver Co-op Radio.
100.5 FM.
CFRO. The People's Radio Station.
Yes, it is. CFRO 100.5 FM, and it's Métis Matters Radio. I'm your host, Eric White Sky Cloud, and my guest today is Dale Haggerty. Hope you guys enjoyed that song. I loved it. It's Quebec Reel, but done by J.J. Lavallee. He's one very talented man, I'm telling you. He's actually, J.J. himself was a two-time Juno Award fiddle player. So, you know, this guy is getting busier and busier and busier all the time. And I'm sure some of you actually were joining us in our Facebook chat room. I've been playing the wooden spoons, folks. Normally we actually use the metal spoons, but I, you know, get wooden spoons, but I still play them, and I enjoy doing it. So if you guys ever get a chance to see what I do, I got some talents besides just talk. What can
don't
I say?
Don't give him a mic.
Yeah, don't give me the mic.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dale knows me well enough. Give me the mic.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Derek, you got lots of words of wisdom. Also, while we're on the subject of Louis Riel and our veterans enough, I got this card, and it's from the Royal Canadian Legion.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't mind, I'd like to read off it. And
yeah, you go ahead, Dale.
This is coming from the Royal Canadian Legions. It says, Aboriginal veterans have both served in the Canadian military forces and as allies from formulating times of war of 1812 to present. Their military contributions were essential to Canada's survival in the early times. The Royal Canadian Legion honors the Aboriginal veterans and their ancestors. You know, I love the Royal Canadian Legions for all the things that they've done for us, but they don't realize that, you know, Aboriginal veterans, see how we're being grouped again against? I'm not an Aboriginal. I'm a Métis, mm-hmm. and I'm very proud of it. And, you know, I was at a ceremony over the weekend, and the Métis weren't even mentioned. The Aboriginal people weren't even mentioned.
Wow.
I just get upset, and you know, and I made a complaint against the president, and you know that they think we're just a club.
Yeah.
You know, they think we're just a club. They don't realize we're a nation of people.
Well, you know what it is, Dale, and I'm sure Cindy can tell you. I mean, Cindy Wilgosh is up in that area. She's actually a person that's been working very hard to help the Métis community along with Dale. And she can tell you, I mean, that area sometimes can be racist.
Oh.
You know, and even we're you know, everyone, we're still having difficulties to, I think what happened was, you know, us as Métis people, we're trying to find our place to fit in and always have been. We're always called the invisible people.
Yeah.
And we're always trying to find our place in. I mean, I remember Bob Kelly, the late Bob Kelly, who was also a veteran, and he said to me when he did a grand entry and we're doing some other, and we're not in the powwow then. This was actually at an event at the border. And I think you were there with me. And I remember the time that we were the last of the people, the group of Métis that were part of the meeting the borders between the United States and Canada.
Yeah.
And they brought all the kids in and they brought all the other people in, but we were the last to come in. And one of the girls got really upset. She goes, well, that's not fair. You know, we were here first. How come we're not first in line? And Bob took the young girl aside and said out loud, "Do you know what? Let me share something with you." And she said, "You could be the first in line, but yet if you're the last in line, the people will remember you. If you're the first in line, they'll forget all about you."
Yeah.
And that made a whole lot of sense.
Oh,
they'll
sure.
always remember if you were the last to be there. So because yeah. we stuck it out, we were in the end. So it makes a difference if we were at the end, because people remember looking at you because they're the last person to leave, because their memory will hang on to what you carry in, who you are, what you look like, your appearance, you know, what you have said. If you're the last person on the mic, they're going to remember you more yeah. than just the first person on the mic. And I've always taken that as an important word and as philosophy, but, you know, we're still dealing with racism everywhere. And I think also, too, last couple of years ago when we went to Parliament, remember, when the Métis were fighting the rights to be recognized in government. And I remember, you know, the guys are running down, the Métis are running downstairs, and I remember watching Paulette Flamand, and she's running downstairs with everybody else, and everybody's excited and going like, "We're recognized by the government now, we're recognized by the government." And then all of a sudden they turn around and said, "You're now First Nations."
Yeah.
We're like, that's not what they came there for. We didn't come to get recognized as First Nations. We're recognized as a Métis community, a Métis people. But they changed it. See how they changed it all up? And next thing you know, all the First Nations people are mad at us, saying, "Oh, they don't deserve to get those rights." I go like, "Excuse me? What the heck do we ask for? We weren't asking for rights of First Nations. We were asking for rights of who we are."
That's right.
You but know, this is where we're misunderstanding the whole story.
It's and don't take this the wrong way, please. I'm just trying to use this as a political statement. How would the German people like to say the Polish people and the German people? You are now German-Polish people together. Yeah. Do you think that that's going to go flying? Not a chance. But, oh, in Canada, let's throw another log in the fire. Yeah. Let's get the Aboriginal communities all upset. Let's call the Inuit snow people and the Métis and the First Nation. We'll just call them Indigenous. How's that? That's good enough, you know. That'll start another war.
To this day, I have
war with everybody. You know what I'm saying?
To this day, Dale, I have no idea why we're called Indigenous. I don't know.
I'm not.
I mean, I can understand when they're saying you're Indigenous to the land. Okay, fine. We're all Indigenous to the land, but
not as a people.
Exactly.
Exactly. Anyways, I don't mean to complain.
I remember Ken Fisher saying, "We're not Indigenous."
Oh, yeah.
We are Métis. We're authentic.
Yeah, you know what? He would be harping all the time. We're Métis. We're Métis. We're not Indians. And excuse me for saying that, but we're not Indians. And we're not ice people. We're Métis people.
That's what he used to,
I remember that's what he used to say.
I know.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
That it's heartbreaking. And the thing is that what we're trying to say is our identity is important.
It is important.
You know, that's all it really is. I mean, I know very well historically we were called the Métis Indian before we were called Métis.
Yeah.
We were called Métis Indian because a lot of our Métis do look like First Nations people because of the lineage of who we are, identity, but
bloodline.
In time, bloodline. But, you know, if you start mixing your bloodline, with, say, with a Scot or an Irish, you know, or French, you're going to look more non-Indigenous than you normally would.
Yeah.
Right?
It's all about genetics.
It's all about genetics. And still,
and
you're still, in my heart, I'm still Métis as far as I'm concerned, because I'm from the East. I don't care what Charchet says. But, you know, 131 years plus years after Riel's execution was carried out, sparking anger among Francophones and celebration in English Canada and a sense of doom among his Métis and Indigenous allies.
Oh, yeah.
Some believe that allowing politicians to rewrite a disputed chapter of Canada's history could instead cause modern-day troubles.
Wow.
Now, Tom Flanagan, He's actually emeritus professor of political science at the University of Calgary. Said the debate over Riel's conviction is better left to legal scholars, but admitted that the status that of the status quo with political leaders singing the praises of a man executed as a traitor leaves an unresolved tension. Like I think he says, he thinks that you should leave history the way it is. What happened happened. I don't think you should try to reverse it, said Flanagan, who has written extensively about Riel's legacy. Now, if there's any, if there is an exoneration, the message is that the government of Canada is saying it's okay to have taken up arms because it was just, it was a just cause. And I think that it was a very dangerous message. And someone had, with George and Terry Goulet, what they wrote here, and this is one of their articles out of their books, and this was written in November of 2012. Louis Riel is the most remarkable person in Métis history, and as their iconic leader, he represents all those valiant Métis who fought for basic human rights, not only for the Métis, but for First Nations and other Canadians. The dynamic Riel was a natural-born leader whose life profoundly influenced Canadian society and politics. Now, the founding of Manitoba and the rights of Western Canadians, his impact continues to this day and will continue into the future. Highly intelligent, well-educated, and a compelling orator, he was elected to the Parliament of Canada on three separate occasions while he was still in his 20s, though due to politics, he was never able to take his seat.
No, they threatened him.
Yeah. So his fascinating life combined the heights of success and the depths of defeat, the sacred and the profane. And to some, he conjoined fame and infamy. To others, he was an iconoclast. He became an icon. To Riel himself, that he had a prophetic mission and to lead and champion his people, the Métis, and having their grievances remedied, their rights obtained, and their lives uplifted. Riel has been called the first prairie populist politician. A plaque occupying the monumental statue of Louis Riel, which stands adjacent to the magnificent Métis legislative buildings in Winnipeg, reads in part as follows. In 1992, Parliament of Canada and the Legislative Assembly of Manitoba formally recognized Riel's contribution to the development of the Canadian Confederation and his role, and that of the Métis as founders of Manitoba. Many of the demands in the Bill of Rights he championed for the Métis and for Westerners in 1885 came to pass after his unjust execution. Results of his leadership of the Métis include Manitoba becoming a province of Canada in 1870, the people of what is now Saskatchewan and Alberta winning the right to vote and be elected members of Parliament in 1886, and responsible government in 1887, and provincial status in 1905. Other notable outcomes inspired by Riel's life include the Métis people being specifically recognized in the Constitutional Act of Canada in 1982, and his being looked upon by the Métis as a hero and their greatest symbol. Riel has been the subject of stage, radio, film, opera, television, documentaries, monuments, and a postage stamp. And more books, biographies, and articles have been written about this charismatic Métis icon than any other Canadian in history. Riel is honored every year in a number of Canadian cities with flag-raising ceremonies. These are held at city halls and other public places, including his gravesite in St. Boniface. Manitoba's statutory family holiday in February has been renamed Louis Riel Day. And then Louis Riel is an inspiration to Métis people. It is as a result of his dedication, leadership, and the legacy that Métis today can be proud to be Métis. And his fight for basic human rights and democracy in Western Canada is truly memorable. Is Riel a hero? If a hero in one of who forfeits his life as a result of fighting for the rights of his people and others is a just cause, then Louis Riel is a hero not only to the Métis, but also to all Canadians who believe in and fight for basic human rights. Long live the memory of Louis Riel.
There you go. There you go. Very, very well said.
You know, there are more things that I was going to add into this story, but we'll do that in just a few minutes. But, you know, We have a lot of relatives that are buried next to Riel, and there's a cenotaph there, and I've got apparently relatives buried there next to Riel. And it's really interesting. I find it interesting that I'm from Manitoba, and I remember, if you look at the Parliament building, Dale, and I'm not sure if you've ever been to Manitoba yourself or Winnipeg, but if you look at the Parliament building, on the top of that Parliament building, they always have this, they call the Golden Boy, right? And it's actually, it's a statue of a gold person running. I think it's supposed to be, what do you call it? Remember seeing that flower business where they have the wings on the heels of that guy? What the heck's that? And what was his name now? Oh my God.
The FedEx man?
Yeah, like the FedEx guy. Well, they actually, they have the same thing that's called the Golden Boy. Like, it looks like he's running on the roof.
Yeah, okay.
Now, I don't know his name, if I remember the name, but if my friend Johnny was here, he'd go like, I know what it is.
Okay. Yeah.
But I think they should replace that Golden Boy, put Riel on the roof.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
By
all means.
Just to spike Canada.
Yeah, yeah.
Make it where he's running with the wings on his feet.
Yeah, there you go.
But not running away, running to.
Yeah.
Right?
You know, this conversation of him being exonerated, you know, this shouldn't be just left in somebody's hands like the president of Manitoba Métis Federation or Clem Chartrand. They shouldn't be left in it. This should be a vote or a census or a referendum, whatever you want to call it,
mm-hmm.
for all Métis people.
Yeah.
Hermes.
There it is.
Oh,
Hermes.
Oh, Dale just said that it's Hermes that's running up there.
Yeah, Hermes. Yeah, well, it should remove Hermes and put in Riel.
Yeah, there you go. You know, so, you know, I don't believe that we have a Métis council guy in Saskatchewan that's representing all of us. He's just representing his own back pockets. And all the leaders today that are in there, they're not representing. Do you know how these guys get voted in?
Dale, I want you to hold on to that thought.
Okay.
You can tell me, because we're going to go on to another song.
All right.
It's called Sheehan's Reel by Mal Bedard. You're listening to CFRO 101.5 FM, Métis Matters Radio. I'm having too much here. Mark,
we're doing hockey announcements.
We're doing hockey announcements.
I think the people on Facebook can hear and see it, but can't hear it on the radio.
We're having too much fun.
Doing Jim Robson and Danny Gallivan.
Yeah.
Jim Robson, you know, he does a Fog Motors commercial. And he sounds like this. And then Greg Adams, Greg Adams! There you go. Back to you, Derek.
We're having too much fun here. See what Métis do? We're having too much fun in the studio. That was Sheehan's Real, Mel Bedard. And that's actually, it's a really old, it's actually an older song. That was actually apparently done back in the 1960s. And I was given this, actually, this wonderful CD was given to me by a good friend of mine. He actually passed these down to me, Mr. Carrier. So I hope he's doing well. And also, we're going to, I wanted to let everybody know, too, coming up right after my program, and after I leave the studio tonight, here every Wednesday night at the Friendship Center, there's a Métis dance night. So if anybody wants to learn how to Métis dance, jig, that sort of thing, you can go down to the Friendship Center right downtown Vancouver, just off Hastings. And there's a room, as you're coming in, go straight in. When you come into the door, go straight to the end. And that's where the Métis dance night, they actually practice every Wednesday night. Yvonne Chartrand is the one who's actually one of the teachers. If not, if she's not there, someone else will be there. So I look forward to seeing you guys. If you want to come down and have a look and see what to find out what all Métis are about. And the thing is that you don't have to be Métis to learn how to jig. We can actually teach you. So this is what we do. Now, Mr. Dale Haggerty is back here, and he wants to say a few words, what his thoughts were regarding Saskatchewan.
Well, first of all, we do have a Métis leader, according to the Constitution, that he goes and he represents us at the Constitution table and whatever.
Yeah.
But do you know how he gets voted in? Every province except Quebec and the eastern provinces, mm-hmm. and I have no idea why they're not in part of all this, because Canada's Canada. Yeah. Yukon and Northwest Territories, they're not included into this talks. So they're trying to say, okay, it's the Red River, Métis, whatever. It's just, again, it's another log on the fire to see if we can all start fighting amongst each other. Anyways, getting back to that, so Manitoba, Saskatchewan, Alberta, and BC, they all have elected leaders in our area and according to our region. So in British Columbia, just for an example, and I'm not too sure how many, but I think there was eight regions. We have eight regions in BC. Mm-hmm. And if I'm wrong, I apologize. So they get eight votes. Same with Alberta. How many regions? They get a vote. Saskatchewan and Manitoba. Oh, and sorry, and we got to include Ontario. Sorry, Ontario brothers and sisters out there, but you guys get a same amount of voting rights out there. And that's how we elect a leader. Well, why don't we all go down to Florida?
Mm-hmm.
And join their Republican Party. Because exactly what they're doing is not allowing us as individuals, 60,000 Métis in British Columbia, and we're represented by eight votes.
Are you trying to tell me that Trump is Métis?
Oh, no, I just found out. I think I found out that Finnegan or Flanagan, whatever his name is, yeah. I think he's a Republican.
Uh-oh, now we're really in trouble. That's probably one of Trump's favorites.
He's pro-Trump. I know it. Okay. Anyways, but this is how our political system works. It's unfair to the Métis people. And if we have 500,000 Métis in Canada, why don't we have 500,000 votes to elect a proper leader?
Yeah.
Instead of this dictatorship of how it's been done. You know, well, we don't have the money. Let's cry another log song and, you know, throw another log in the fire, and this is how we're going to disrupt Métis again.
Yeah.
If we all got our stuff together, we'd say enough is enough. We'd take these leaders that are leading us and, excuse me, send them down to the Republican Party. because that's exactly how useless they are to us.
Yeah.
And I can say this because I can say it.
Yeah.
What are you going to do to me? I'm Métis.
We're going to come down to Clearwater and come and have a chat with you.
Oh, that's great. I'd love to do that. Maybe I can get a couple logs thrown on my fire.
Yeah. What I want to share, I want everybody to know this too, Dale, is the BC Métis Federation this week for November the 16th. The BC Métis Federation members are invited to join the flag raising for Louis Riel Day on Friday, November the 16th at sunrise. That's 7:22 a.m. located at the flagpole outside the legislature nearest to the Menzies Street in Victoria here in British Columbia.
Wow, that's fabulous. I'll be putting my Métis flag out for the day.
Yeah.
And there you go. I have a Métis flag. And by the way, everybody, this is my opinion. This has got nothing to do with anything that's got anything to do with what I do in my background life. This is my opinion, and this is how I feel.
Yeah. It's called the views and opinions of Dale Haggerty.
You know, none of this right in the speech thing. I don't need a speech to tell you how I feel. You know,
the British
for our people instead of working for yourself.
Yeah. The British Columbia government has raised the Métis flag and declared Louis Riel Day for the last 3 years or so. Many others, cities in BC and other provinces have raised the Métis Infinity flag, including Victoria, Langford, and Williams Lake. So now we're all going to be raising our flags. So, and I don't care if the flag is blue or red, folks. Métis is Métis.
Yeah, it's the infinity that counts.
Well, I want to thank you guys. Thank folks for listening to us. Dale, we're coming to an end. We have come to an end. Oh, thank you so much, my friend, for coming on the program.
Thanks for putting up with me and listening to me. Thank you, everybody. Have a great Louis Riel Day.
You guys have a great day. This is Derek White, Sky Cloud, and this is Jimmy's Breakdown at Métis Matters Radio, CFRO 100.5 FM. We'll talk to you guys next week.